Welcome to another service, and a very special service because it's Mission Sunday. It's the fifth Sunday in the week, and every fifth Sunday is the Mission Sunday. And church, you know that New Calvary Church is committed to supporting missionaries. And each year we not only have reminders at our Mission Sunday about our missionaries and the importance of missions, but I also want to remind you that the month of November, starting next week, will be our month of missions, when we will be focusing on the subject of missions and focusing on the theme that God is giving us as we focus on ministering to everybody in our church on the significance of missions. When Jesus Christ made his last statement to his disciples, he said, "All power has been given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and make disciples of all people. Lo, I'm with you always, even unto the ends of the earth." And church, I hope that you will remember this, that God's passion is that he gave us his Holy Spirit. And when his Holy Spirit came upon the disciples, they went into Jerusalem and into Judea and into Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the world. And these 12 men turned the world upside down. Have you ever considered the question, what could God do with me? What could he do with New Calvary Church? What could he do with all the churches that are in our world? If you're focused on the mission of God Church, God can take us. And even if we make the simplest and the smallest goal this year and say, God willing, in the next 12 months, I would like to see 10 people discipled through my life in this nation or in the nations of the world, wherever you are, so that God will take you and you will become his primary instrument. I believe the world will not be the same. But the mission is not about just preaching. The mission is not about just teaching. The mission is not about just going. The mission is not about just baptizing. The mission is about making disciples for Jesus Christ. And church, I hope that as you begin to think about your responsibility by the end of this month, by the end of this year, with the beginning of next year, and in the year 2023, would you consider making a covenant with God to say, I will be a disciple maker for Jesus Christ? Can you turn to your family and say that to each other? I will be a disciple maker for Christ. I will be a disciple maker for Christ. If you were at church, I probably would have said, I can't hear you. I still can't hear you, but can I ask you to say that to one another? I will be a disciple maker for Christ. And with that, I want to welcome you to our Mission Sunday, and I hope that you will have an amazing time listening to the Word of God and the challenge for missions. But as we prepare our hearts this morning, will you pray with me? And may we ask God to minister to our hearts so that we will be God's instrument to fulfill his mission, as we are reminded on this fifth Sunday of our responsibility for his mission. And so, Father, we come into your presence realizing we are a people that are missional. You gave us a mission and a vision. You told us to go into all the world, and the mission was to make disciples of all ethnic communities. We live in a world with so many different ethnic communities, and some of them who had never once heard that Jesus lives, that he came, he suffered, he died, and he rose again so that we can be reconciled to you. Father, New Calvary Church is committed to this task, and we give our tithes and our resources and our faith promise for the purpose of proclaiming Jesus Christ everywhere. Lord, would you be with us this morning as we listen to your word, as we worship you, that we will realize mission exists because worship doesn't, and that we would like to see worshipers everywhere in every people group. And so, Lord Jesus, as we worship this morning, as we praise you, as we worship you, remind us that there are people who do not know you and need to come to know you so that they can worship you. And so, Lord Jesus, we come at this morning into your care with thankfulness and praise of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who came, suffered, and died that we might have life and have it abundantly. Speak, Lord, for your servants heareth. We ask this all in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, Amen. Let's worship the Lord. And as we worship, think of those who are not accessible to worshiping Jesus Christ.
Hello, church. It's indeed a great joy for me to be back and worship with all of you once again. Psalm 23 verse 4 says, Even though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You know, it's not at all easy for anyone to go through any darkest valley in their life. As a child of God, we don't need to be afraid because our shepherd walks along with us in that darkest valley. We can take comfort in that because he protects us, he guides us, he guards us with his rod and staff. As you're listening to me this morning, if you're walking through any darkest valley in your life, I would like to encourage you to walk along with this shepherd. I assure you that you will see light coming ahead of you. Till then, take hold on him.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I won't fear no
Yes, I can see a light that is coming.
Psalm 27, 13 and 14 says, I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong and take heart, wait on the Lord.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are.
Our loving Heavenly Father, we want to praise and thank you for this morning. Thank you for ministering to us, Lord Jesus. Thank you for the confidence that you have given, that you walk with us, you protect us, you guard us in all that we go through, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that you will continue to encourage us when we are down, when we go through darkest valley in our lives, Lord Jesus. Lord, as we sit some more time in your presence and listen from your word, I pray that your words will minister to us in a very special way, Lord Jesus. In your sweet, precious name I pray. Amen.
I trust the songs that you sang this morning were songs that helped you understand that God has us in this world with a purpose. And that purpose is somehow that every man, every woman, every boy, every girl will have the opportunity to hear, know, and worship the Lord Jesus Christ. And church, I hope as you listen to the Word of God this morning, as Dr. Manohar John comes to minister God's Word, mobilize your vision and heart to the task of world missions, locally and globally, that you will intently listen so God can speak to you and allow you to be part of what He is doing. And now, Mano, will you minister to us this day?
Greetings to you in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is a great joy this morning to preach the Lord's word to you in this morning's service. And as we have come through the end of the month of October, God has been faithful to us. He has never left us down. He has been carrying us throughout this month. And as we are come through two drastic years of sickness, pain, and now recovering back to our normal life, many of our Christian lives have also gone ups and downs. And we have seen that many of us who had a powerful Christian life before this COVID or earlier in the Christian walk with the Lord have totally changed because of a lot of circumstances. And this morning, my message that I have titled is, Do We Live a Fruit-Bearing Life? Or Is My Life Bearing Fruit? Today, many of our Christians fail because they had forgotten what they heard, or they have forgot what the words they heard and hid in their heart. Many times, you find in the Bible also, when the sower sows the seed, some fell on the hard ground, some fell in the thorny place, some fell in the fertile land, some the birds had taken it up. Many of our Christian walk also is like that. We had forgotten the word. Every Sunday you heard the word of God. Every time there is a word that comes and encourages you and me. But many times we fail because the word does not become reality. And that reality does not make us to live a life which could bear fruits. Secondly, many of us fail because we yield to this world, the pressures of this world, the stresses of this world, the calling of this world. And sometimes we are also falling to unprepared sudden temptation. Today we have come to a world where we are falling into temptation, unknowing that it is going to take us away from God, or our lives are going to change, and that is going to bring a black mark in our spiritual walk with our Lord. Many of us fail to be watchful. The Bible says always, be vigilant and watchful. Many times because we are not watchful, the devil just wipes us out, takes us away from the Christ-filled life. And there are many Christians who are not fervent to the Lord, or they are not against Him, but they become indifferent to Him. Saying to say, many of us live a lukewarm Christian life, as you find in the book of Revelation, where when there is a writing about the seven churches, I will pew you out, says the Lord. And the last thing why many Christians are not able to serve the Lord in a fruitful manner is we neglect the study of the Word of God. The importance that we give to the Word of God has become less. We listen to online videos, we listen to online music, we listen to online messages, but we don't spend time reading the Word of God. Why today many of us are not able to live a fruit-bearing life is because there are researches which has been made which shows us that there are a lot of reasons behind it. But I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. But today, my message is based on John chapter 15, verses 1 to 17 and 27. John chapter 15, verses 1 to 17 and 27. How to live a fruit-bearing life. How to live a fruit-bearing life. I was just thinking and contemplating and what God wants to teach from this. It's been something very important, I thought, as Christians we need to know. Our identity comes from we bearing fruit. It does not come from power, money, education, or any other souls, but only by bearing fruit for Christ. For any Christian or any person who says, I have no Christ, our identity doesn't come from our job. It doesn't come from our education. It doesn't come from money. It doesn't come from our surrounding. It does not come from the church you and I go, but it comes from the fruit you and I bear. The gospel speaks of fruit-bearing life as an important part of a person who knows Jesus Christ. It's an important thing you and I need to know. In the gospels, if you find, there are more than three times Jesus has personally talked about living a fruitful life. Or he had done something with when he had gone to see a tree or a plant which did not bear fruit. Bible speaks about living a fruit-bearing life in three or more places. In Luke chapter 13 verses 6 to 9, beautifully says, he told a parable, a man had a fig tree growing in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit, but he did not find it. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, for 3 years now I've been coming and looking for the fruit on this fig tree and I haven't found a fruit. Cut it down. One of the things is it's a harsh decision. Jesus says that in this parable, 3 years the master has been coming again and again and again, but he never found a fruit. He never found a life that could reflect Christ. He never found that this tree could be a blessing to others. So he says it is cutting down. He comes out, why should it use up the soil? It's a warning for you and me this morning to say that if you and I as a Christian do not bear fruit, our God is a God who cuts it off and takes away that relationship you and I hold. That's why many times you and I as Christians face a lot of challenges. God is very, very powerful in it. It is a type of curse I think God puts on it. But let me come to Matthew chapter 21 verse 18 to 20. Early in the morning, as Jesus was on the way back to the city, he was hungry. Seeing the fig tree by the road, he went up to it and found nothing, only leaves. Many times our Christian walk is just a leaf. It just keep going. Morning, Sunday, why do you come to church? To just meet people or to just attend the worship or attend to listen to some ear-soothing messages. And we go back. But when we go back, we don't bear fruit. Seeing fig tree by the road, he went up to the and found on it except nothing except leaves. Then he said to it, may you never bear fruit again. Immediately the tree withered. When you and I do not bear fruit, our Christian life withered. That's why many of us have a defeated Christian life. Many times we don't understand. We would be saying, I'm a born again Christian. But you and I have a defeated life, because when Jesus sees you and me, he wants something from you and me. Thirdly, Matthew chapter 17 verses 17 to 20. Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree it cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear a good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. First time it is cut down, second time it withers, third time it is cut down and thrown into fire. But this morning, God is serious about every person who knows him, and he wants them to live a fruit-bearing life. God is serious about you and me. It is not that you watch this video or you watch this message and say, yes, I've watched this. I've gone through this passage in and out again. But have we put it in action? When we miss bearing fruit, these are the consequences sometimes you and I face. Not bearing fruit makes one fail the purpose of his calling. Why was the plant put into that place? It was put into that place so that it would bear fruit. When Jesus came to see that fruit, he was upset because it did not fulfill its calling. Not bearing fruit makes one fail the purpose of his calling. Not bearing fruit leads to unanswered prayers. When you and I don't bear fruits, why should God answer our prayers? Because we are not useful. Not bearing fruit brings dishonor to God. We hurt God. Not bearing fruit excludes one from being a part of his body, Christ. That's why in the John chapter 15, when we come across, we sign that I'm the vine, you're the branches. That relationship is broken. Not bearing fruit leads us to the act of refusing to continue to follow Jesus. When you and I do not bear fruits as Christian, it is to say, I do not want to have a relationship with you. And this morning, I would like to speak from John chapter 15 verses 1 to 17 and 27. Okay, you may ask me a question. Brother, how is it that we can live a fruit-bearing life? Might be I have been a Christian. I have been living a life where I have so long lived for myself. I was more contented with myself. I was only enjoying my growth within myself. I was enjoying my education. I was enjoying my wealth. I was enjoying my family. I was enjoying within myself. It was I. But how now can I bear fruit? But I want to bring you some quickly some points so that I could try to push this point towards you today so that God would minister to you. John chapter 15 verses 1 to 17. How can we live a fruit-bearing life? Verse 1 beautifully says, I am the true vine and my Father is the gardener. I am the vine, you are my branches. So it says that I am the vine, you and I are his branches. And beautifully, the first point for you and me to bear fruit is we need to abide in him. Meaning to say, in certain versions it says we need to remain in him. He wants us to have a very close relationship. Verse 4 beautifully says, remain in me and I also remain in you. He says, first you remain in me. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. I hope you have seen a vine plant growing. If you go and look at it, if you see the kind of connection it has, the vine has it with its branches, it's beautiful. It keeps growing taller, taller, taller. The branch grows, splits up. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. Beautifully in verse 4 and verse 5, he again and again insists on remain in me. In some version it said abide with me, live with me, have a constant relationship with me. He does not talk about a relationship that is a broken. Suppose you take a vine plant growing. You could find a branch slightly broken. It will never ever have to give, it will never ever be able to give a fruit. It has to be totally connected with that vine in order to give. The branch has to be totally connected. We need to get rooted in him. Many times our Christian life and walk with God is just as a outward level or at the bottom level or at the top level. We never ever have a deeper relationship with him. This morning I want to put a question to all those who are listening. Have you and I have a personal relationship with him? If you and I have a broken relationship, you and I will have no value. We need to have a deep relationship with him. How do I have a deep relationship? My heart has to be given to him fully. You should say, Lord, I surrender. I give myself, take control of every part of my life this morning. Many times it's me I thought could do bear fruit. I thought I can do things on my own. But the Bible clearly says, and John, in the book of John, Jesus beautifully says, remain in me. Many times when you and I don't remain in him, we are lost. Might be you and I know Jesus. You and I have a tight attachment with Jesus. Might be Sunday morning you come and give your offering. You have a slight attachment with Jesus. Might be Sunday morning you come and listen to the music and sing and praise him. You have a slight attachment. Might be you come and listen to the word of God. You have a slight attachment. But you need to have the full attachment with him. Full personal relation that comes when your life lives a life of Christ. So this morning, the first thing, if you and I need to bear fruit, you and I should remain in him. If our life is not in him this morning, are we remaining with the world? Are we attached with the wonders of this world? Are we attached with the needs of this world? Are we attached with the fantasies of the world? Detach from that and attach with Christ. Detach from that and attach with Christ. The second point you and I need to know, if our lives have to bear fruit, we need to allow God to prune our lives. We need God to take away those things. Allow God to give away those things and cleanse us by His blood. Verse 2 says, He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, He prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. If you want to be a powerful man of God, powerful man of women of God, a powerful young person who want to serve the Lord, you and I should give. Lord, I allow myself to come out of this habit of anger. They come out of the habit of telling lies. Pride rules me. We need to leave those things which are hindering our Christian walk. Many times I ask people, how was your outward life and your inward life? Both tally together. Many times our outward life is said, praise the Lord. Inward we have anger, we have pride, we have ego. Many times that's why many families are broken. Many relationships are broken because outside I'm an other person and inside I'm another person. But Christ wants you to have one person in you. That will have only when you have relationship and you allow God to prune you. How many of you still hold anger with you? How many of you still hold pride with us? How many of us still hold hatred with us? We need to remove. It can be removed only when you come to the cross of Calvary. And when we say, Lord, wash me and cleanse me. When David was fallen in the sin of adultery, beautifully in Psalms he said, create in me a clean heart, O Lord. Renew a right spirit in me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. And take not thy Holy Spirit. Restore unto me the joy of salvation. And renew a right spirit in me. That is cleaning. Today, do you want to be fruitful? Come back to Him. Leave the things that you're still holding as a Christian, as a person who says, I know Christ, I've accepted Christ. But still the things which are hurting, why is there a problem in your family? Are you not talking with your husband? Are you not talking with your wife? Are you not talking with your children? Young man, young women, are you talking with your father and mother? If you're not doing, there is something that has to be pruned this morning. But you say, I belong to God. Beautifully in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25, 28, 31 says, put off falsehood and speak truthfully. Anyone who has been still stealing must not steal longer. Get 31 says, get rid of bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander among you from every form of malice. Thirdly, we need to be strong in the word of God. Today, nothing else could take us through this walk in this world. Verse 7 beautifully says, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done. The greatest secret of the answer of prayer and to bear fruit is to be strong in the word. When you start bearing fruit, the Bible beautifully says, you see, look at this verse. If you, my words remain in you, whatever you wish, it will be done. So there is nothing that is a hidden secret. When you and I start bearing fruit, if you keep my commands, verse 10 beautifully says, you will remain in my love just as I kept my Father's command and remain in His love. Beautifully, Psalm 119 verse 11 says, I have hidden your word in my heart that I may not sin against you. Psalm 119 verse 105, it says, your word is a lamp to my feet and light to my path. Your word is a lamp unto my feet. What is our lamp today? Is it our own efforts? What have I hid in my heart this morning? Have I hid the word of God in my heart? When I hid the commandment, that's how beautiful it says, if you remain in my words. So when I remain in His words, whatever I ask, in faith, whatever you ask, it will be done. But you and I, you and I remain in His word, God makes us to know what we need to ask. We will not ask things which will bring glory for us. We will not ask things which could make us great. We will ask things which will make us to bear fruit, which will make us to make people who would be a light unto this world. Fourthly, remain in His love. That's a beautiful verse. Chapter 15, verse 9. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. As the Father loved me. So John 3:16 say, for God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, and whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And that is the love Christ wants you and me to have. Remain in His love. Wow. Remain in His word. Remain in His relationship. What a beautiful God you and I have. As the Father loved me, if you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I kept my Father's command. So if you and I are strong in the word, it is Christ who loved us first, not we. Many times we say, no, I gave my life to Christ. As if we are given some, we are doing something. I left this habit for Christ. No, it is Christ who loved us. I have loved you. Today, this is a word. He says, I have loved you. Still, He says, when the gardener looks at the tree, he finds it not bearing fruit for 3 years. Still, the gardener asks, give me some more time. That's the love. Christ has given us some more time in this world. Mind it, the COVID has not taken you. Might be that heart attack not taken you. Might be an accident has not taken you. Because still He says, I know this, my son, my daughter, my child will bear fruit. You will be a light unto this world. Romans 5:8 beautifully said, but God proves His love for us in this. While we were yet still sinners, Christ died for us. That is a beautiful thing. I have loved you. He died on the cross to prove it. It is not the word that alone. In John 21, beautifully asked, Jesus asked Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these things? That is the thing Christ asks you. Remain in His love. Do you love me more than this thing? Second time, verse 16 says, Simon, son of John, do we love me? Third time, verse 17, Simon, son of John, do we love me? That is to say, He so loves, as a father He has loved me, so I have loved you. That is what He wants to get that close. When you and I have the love of Christ very close, the worldly love, the worldly things that attack us will have no meaning. The worldly distractions that has not have any meaning. Fifthly, we should understand that He chose us and we did not choose Him. Many times we think, no, I accepted Christ. I gave my life to Christ. I gave my smoking to because Christ came into me. I done it. I gave my tithes. I gave this for God. But He says, we should understand that He chose us. Lord, You chose us by giving that blood on the cross. That's why He says beautifully in the previous one. So, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved. Now remain in my love. He wants you to be in the love so that you understand that He has chosen you. He has chosen us. From the miry clay, the life that you and I lived was so pitiable, not even a person was able to come close to you. When the prodigal son was eating what the pigs were eating, it was the father's hand that embraced him when he came back. Father ran. The Bible says the father ran to see the son. That is the love. It is He who chose you. If you and I are sitting and if I am preaching this morning, this message, dear brothers and sisters who are sitting and watching this message, understand, Lord, You chose me. I called you friends for everything that I have learned from my Father. I made you to know you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might bear fruit. It is Christ who has chosen us. There are millions and billions of people, but Christ has chosen you. If this morning, if you are listening to this message, Christ has chosen you to listen so that you would bear more fruit. Deuteronomy chapter 14 verse 2 says, for you are the people holy to the Lord God, and the Lord has chosen you to the people for his treasured possession out of all people who are on the face of the earth. From all the people you have been chosen. Oh, I want to read that again. For you are a people holy to the Lord your God, and the Lord has chosen you to be a people of his treasured possession. You are a treasured possession. I am a treasured possession out of all the people who are on the face of the earth. There are so many people. Why did they not know the Lord? Because you have been chosen. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 3 and 4. Blessed be the God, the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, who has been blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy, blameless before him. Before the foundation of the world. It is not you. It is not by crook or thing. Might be even if you had been a greatest sinner, a murderer, knowing Christ. Christ has chosen you. It is not that you have made a choice. The next one that we see is, we need to love one another. Verse 12 says beautifully, my command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Be remain in my love is one. When I remain in his love, I will love one another. This is the command, love each other. Verse 12 and verse 17. Beautifully said, if you need to bear fruit, you need to love one another. 1 John 4, 7, dear friend, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. 1 John 3, 18, dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but action and truth. Let our love be in action and truth. So much of hatred comes out of this mouth. So much of anger comes out of this mouth. So much of vices. So much of hypocrisy comes out. And we try to think that God doesn't know. He knows you and me. He knows your name. Because beautifully he says in this beautiful day, he has chosen us before the foundation of the earth. And he knows who I am. And he has given you and me a chance to bear fruit. Might be you and I, after hearing this message, still live a life not bearing fruit. I think there are things that the Bible gives us as an answer. I'll cut you down. You and I will wither. I will cut you down and throw you into fire. Finally, you and I must bear witness. Verse 27. And you also must testify you have been with me from the beginning, sharing the word of God. First of all, unless you and I share a word of God, the fruit you and I have cannot be known to these people. When you talk, they will know the love you have. When you talk, they will know the relationship you have with Christ. When you talk, they know the word that is controlling you. When you talk, they know that when you pray, the prayers will be answered. This morning, I want to leave again. Remind this 7 point. You and I need to remain in him. If you need to and I need to bear fruit, we need to allow God to prune us. Lord, remove that. Sometimes God may hurt us in the process of pruning. No, when God, the guy who prunes, if you look, he'll take a scissors, cut it. It may pain. Sometimes when there is pain in our life, don't think that God is not with us. It is him who's pruning that you and I may bear fruit. You and I need to be strong in the word. We need to remain in his love. In us, so anything that is going to come, whether Paul says, in every situation, I will not leave you. The love of God empowers me that I will not leave you in any situation. We should understand that he has chosen us and you and I did not choose him. We need to love one another. Finally, you and I need to bear witness and testimony. Shall we close our eyes this morning? Are we bearing fruit this morning? God has spoken to you this morning. I'm just another person God has used this morning. You and I have read this passage again and again. But wherever you're listening, if God has spoken and you say, yes, Lord, so long I lived a life without love. I did not love you the way I need to love you. I did not read the word I need to read. I did not have the relationship with you as I should have. I did not allow you to prune me. This morning, Christ wants to enter in your life. He wants you to be a person who can bear fruit. You can be a blessing to many. Your prayers would be answered. Your life would show many, 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 many things which would happen in a different way. Our Heavenly Father, this morning, thank you for speaking with your children. And Lord, if there's anyone committing their life saying, yes, Lord, so long I lived a life without bearing fruit. There are areas where I need to correct. Make me the way I need to live. That in the coming days that I would bear fruit in such a way that I would bear be a person who would be a witness in this great society. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. With us in this morning service, may God speak with you and start meditating on what you have learned this morning. I know God will do great things in your life and you will bear a witness. Shall we have the benediction? May the grace of our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ, the love and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen.